Welcome, everybody, to the Zorich podcast. I have Notre Dame legend Lee Becton, and I am Chris Zorich, and we're kind of going a little high tech here. I'm going to play a little intro for everybody, and I hope you like it. I'm kind of pumped about it. I didn't produce it, but my wife did, so you'll enjoy it. Give me like a half a second. Now, is that big time or what?
Man, that was pretty cool. I didn't know you could catch that much good footage of me. Your wife did a good job.
Man, you know, and here's the funny thing, and this is kind of how it started. Literally, she was like, dude, what are you doing? And I'm like, well, what? I'm working out. You know, I'm working a little bit, you know, doing my thing, doing appearance. She's like, no. You're spending far too much time in this house. You need to do something. And so it was actually her idea that we came up with this podcast. And she was like, look, you got a lot of friends. You play for Notre Dame, just call them up. I'm like, okay, I don't know what to do. And so literally I was like scouring the internet for like how to put a podcast together 101. And we've kind of evolved a little bit. First we're on Zoom, as I mentioned to you before. And now we're actually doing it a little bit higher end. On StreamYard, which is cool because we got a couple of graphics, like, you know, we can see it. So before, I couldn't do stuff like this. Oh, see?
I mean, look at you.
Hey, man, you got to watch out. And here's the big part. I got to do it all by myself. So,
wow.
It's not like somebody over here going, oh, you can do that, you can do this. So I have to do all this stuff by myself. So we're actually evolving, and you're going to be one of the first guests to actually get the full extent at the half minute or at the half halftime mark. We got a little commercial as well. So, you know, hey man, we're just trying to do what we're gonna do.
I feel privileged, man. I'm glad I got to get to experience this with you.
All right. Well, I'm gonna get started. So I mean we have a ton of stuff to talk about. I mean the idea and this is what kind of I try and do on our podcast. Is that I kind of throw all the stats out the window. We're not going to sit here and talk about, I mean, obviously we're talking about your favorite game, stuff like that. But we're not going to talk about how many touchdowns you had, how many tackles you had, you know, how many passes you threw. This is not what this is about. This is just about hanging out. I do have to mention the first one I did was with Tony Rice. And when I told him we're just going to hang out, he kind of took that to another level and finished the bottle of wine. We're only our show, so I don't know. You know, he was at the end. He was just drinking from the bottle at that point.
Hey, I got my water.
All right,
no bottle of wine.
There you go. Fair enough. Thank you, sir. So, I mean, we're going to start off first by talking about kind of how you got involved in football, and if you were kind of one of those all sports guys, or you just one sport. Was football even your main sport?
So it's a kind of a funny story. You know, coming from a small town in North Carolina.
What's the name of it now?
Wow. Ernul, North Carolina.
What is the population there?
Back then it was roughly 400 people.
How many stops are there?
We had one at the beginning of town. Just one. And that was it. But a great place to grow up. Everybody knew everybody, so I loved it. But you know, it was funny. I started, of course, in Pop Warner like everybody at the age of 9, and you know, it was all the other kids were already playing, and I was just dying to play. And I got the opportunity, and just did well, excelled at it. It was kind of easy for me, or it felt easy for me. Mm-hmm. But I was kind of a big 9-year-old. I remember every game we'd go to, either I was trying to lose weight before the game because I had to step on the scale, and then I'd eat afterwards. So it was quite the chore to try to actually play in a game.
Okay, so did you have any siblings that participated in sports? Were you the only child, or
what was so my my older brother played as well.
Okay.
He was 3 years older than me, and so he played, you know, up. And I remember that we used to have to practice against them. And I was like, yeah, my brother, because my brother was pretty tough. He wasn't as big, but he was just okay. Tough. And I was like, man, I really hope my brother takes it easy on me. He absolutely did not, which was fine. You know?
Of course.
Because then when we went and played kids that were our age, it was a piece of cake.
Right. So did you guys want to go to the same school? Was there any pressure? Did he play high school sports or?
Yeah. So I did football, basketball, and track, the normal. Okay. My brother did pretty much the same. We played not even a full season, but I came up from my junior year, my freshman year. I got to play in the second to last game of the varsity game.
Okay.
Against our rival, and it was kind of a touching moment. The coach ended up putting me in the game around the 3 yard line. And I was taking my brother out because we played the same position.
Wow.
Yeah, it's tough coming into the game. Your brother's a senior, you're a freshman, and then the coach gives you the ball. You score the touchdown. So, but it was a touching moment. I'm running off the field, and he gives me a hug, you know. So, you know, wow. it was a great bonding moment for us and a great feeling for me.
And you probably had to score, because if you didn't score – that would have been maybe one of the most embarrassing moments as opposed to one of the touching moments of your career?
You got that correct. There was no way I was not getting in the end zone.
So were you a sports family? I mean, were your parents were they involved? Did they drive you to games and stuff like that? Did you guys get pressure from your parents to participate in sports? Or how did that start off?
My mom was she didn't participate in a lot of sports herself, but she was definitely supportive throughout from 9 all the way through high school. She missed one of my games ever.
Wow.
And that was only because she had to sing in a church choir. Because you know God comes first. So she had to do that. But all my other games, she was there. She was there to rub me down when I'm sore. She was there. She, you know, every practice, it wasn't just me, my cousins, everybody. She was that sports mom.
Okay. But was she one of those moms that like yelled and told you what to do, told the coach what to do, or was she kind of reserved in that area?
Oh, she was very reserved. I remember a game. I got a little injured during the game. And of course, the crowd is silent. Everybody's wondering what's going on, what's happening. And I remember somebody telling me after the game that they were like, your mom just sat there. And everybody's like, are you not worried? Are you not running down on the field? She was like, no, he'll be all right. Watch, he'll get back up and get out there and play. And sure enough, got up and got out there. But she was just that calm mom that lets you do your thing, let the coaches coach you. And yeah, it was awesome.
Nice. Okay, so when your brother – did you and your brother go to the same – I mean, obviously you guys went to the same school, but same high school, right?
Yes,
okay,
absolutely.
So was it a situation where, like – I mean, since your brother had already been there, were teachers – what was your brother's name? I'm sorry, I'm talking to him like I don't know what's his name.
Oh, Anthony.
Okay, so they were like, you know, hey, you better be as good as Anthony, or Anthony didn't do it this way, or – I mean, did you get pressure – like that?
I didn't. You know, so from a young age, I was just considered to be the next good football player coming from our high school.
Okay.
And so I never got that pressure, The one thing I did do is as soon as he graduated, I took his number, which was 22.
Oh, really? I mean, was that kind of like an honor thing for you, or?
It was.
Okay.
It really was. My brother, like I said, my brother wasn't as big as I was, but he was one of the toughest players you would ever want to play with. I mean, he had to be probably 5'8", maybe 160 pounds, 65, really? And played linebacker like relentlessly.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so it was a great honor to carry on something that he started.
Okay, so you talked about when you had a chance to come in and relieve him and score the touchdown. Were you like the man in high school? I mean, did you have like a gazillion yards, or you know, were you just a hard, gritty player?
I did pretty well.
Being modest now, how many yards did you have in your high school career?
I had over 5,000 and like 83 touchdowns, something like that.
Jeez. Oh yeah, so yeah. By the way, high school is like 50 years ago for us, so this is this is funny how we can just rattle off the stats. Oh yeah, you know. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, so when did school start talking to you? Like maybe your junior year? I mean, obviously you were very successful. I mean, I'm assuming North Carolina was all over you, but like what schools were looking at you?
I was getting recruited roughly starting my freshman year. People knew who I was in the state within North Carolina. My high school had sent a few guys up to NC State, so they knew of me. They had a great relationship with my high school coach. So they knew who I was, and so they were recruiting me hard. Then Carolina, East Carolina. It wasn't until probably my junior year that I started to get a little bit more national attention.
Okay.
And that's when I got some Miamis and Michigans and Penn States and different people like that started showing interest.
Okay, so when all the mail stuff is coming to your house, I mean, obviously your family's excited about that. So, I mean, are you just trying to play it off? You know, you're trying to be like, yeah, hey, this is cool, or look what I got today, or, I mean, and I'm assuming coaches are coming up to the high school and stuff like that. Are you just like, yeah, I'm the man, or are you just like, oh, no, hey, you know, that's what happens. I mean, how did you handle all that?
It really wasn't... I really was like just chill about it because, okay, you know, for me, everything that I did out on the field was all about my teammates.
Okay.
You know, the guys in front that's blocking for me. I had great receivers that blocked for me downfield. So everything I did, it was all about them. So I never really was like, oh, well, there was one time. One time when Vinny Serrato showed up, then I was like, no way. There's no way Notre Dame is here.
By the way, hold on. Vinny Serrato was the recruiting coordinator for Notre Dame, and the slick dude. you know, he was almost like a car salesman. I mean, could literally sell ice to an Eskimo. And eventually, after he left Notre Dame, I think he was with the 49ers for a while.
Yeah.
And he bounced around the league, but go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So, but the majority of the time, people would say, hey, we just saw somebody from Penn State or Michigan or whomever. And I'd be like, okay, that's fine. The thing was, in my mind at that time, I was going to stay close to home.
Okay.
You know, my mom had seen all my games. I couldn't imagine at the time playing a football game without my mom in the stands. So sure. I was pretty well set to stay close to home.
Okay. So Vinny Serrato comes through.
Oh, Vinny. You just said he could sell, what'd you say?
Ice to an Eskimo.
Ice to an Eskimo, exactly. You got a kid from North Carolina that then goes to something like the frozen tundra in South Bend.
Well, before we do that, so, like, what were your final five schools? Do you remember what they were, who they were?
Yeah, it's pretty easy.
Okay.
East Carolina, North Carolina, North Carolina State, South Carolina, and Notre Dame. You see a trend there?
So please, I mean, did you go to the other, did you go on other visits or like, did you already know folks there? I mean, you mentioned you had guys from the high school that went there, but I mean, was it just old hat for you or, I mean, did you go on
those visits? It was an old hat, but I did go on my official visits to all of them, but it was an old hat. I knew people at East Carolina because the proximity to my high school, there was a lot of just, you know, friends there and a couple players and, Jesse Campbell was playing at NC State at the time. So I used to go up there and watch him play. Wow. The only two places I didn't really know anybody. Well, I knew people at North Carolina as well. I just didn't know anybody at South Carolina.
Okay. So did you enjoy yourself at that visit?
On which one?
South Carolina.
It was interesting. It was okay. It was tough, to say the least. It's just it's a little bit different down there. A little different.
I mean, out of the schools you named, I mean, that's the only SEC school. And so, I mean, did you go up for a game? Or I've been up there once, and I thought it was, and again, I mean, I just had been in Notre Dame games, but it was my first SEC game, and it was by far one of my best experience going to a game in my life.
Yeah, for me, it wasn't that. It was the camaraderie within the team wasn't the same as it was at other places, and that was a problem for me.
Okay, so at some point, you take a visit to the frozen tundra. Hopefully, on your recruiting visit, it wasn't snowing. Was it?
It wasn't, but it was the normal gray sky. it felt wet, but like 26 degrees, but no snow. You were actually there.
Really?
Practicing. Yeah, you guys were practicing because I came in December. You guys were practicing for the Orange Bowl, I think.
Okay, yeah.
And I remember walking in because I got there late. I didn't get there till Saturday because I had a basketball game. But I remember walking in, and I'm walking in, and I'm looking around, and the first thing I see is I see Rocket just take off down the field. And I was like, why does that guy have a – jetpack on his back? Like, this makes no sense. Wow. And then the next thing I saw was you hit somebody, and I said, that guy right there will never hit me. Not happening.
That's but crazy.
I enjoyed my visit there.
Do you remember who your host was?
Another North Carolina kid, Walter Boyd.
Oh wow, yeah, I remember Walter. Okay. Did he wear 28?
I believe so. I believe he did.
That's so weird. And I know this for a fact, right? I guarantee you, you can name almost 5 to 10 of your guys from high school and remember their jersey numbers, which is insane, right?
That is insane.
And so when I need to remember like phone numbers and stuff like that, I actually use jersey numbers of my friend. so I can remember, and then I'll write it down. But isn't that so weird how randomly, like, you would remember, like, I mean, I'll never forget Rocket's number, obviously. But then also, like, there's this guy named Dave Jandrick who actually had 4 before you did. Like, it's just random. And I just thought about that because I know that's your number, but I thought about guys – who I knew, and also a guy named Tom Byrne. It's so weird how
that is.
And I talked to other people about this, and it's kind of just a weird fact with, I guess, athletes. Like, you tend to always remember numbers and your fellow teammates. So it's just so weird. So I didn't mean to digress with that, but I just thought it was weird.
No, that's pretty awesome. I remember some. I don't know if I'm as good as you, but I remember some.
No. I got hit in the head too many times. I guarantee that. So you got Rocket there, So at this, so let me backtrack a little bit. At any point, did Holtz make the trip to the small town? Did he ever come talk to your parents or your family or?
He did. He did.
Okay. How'd that
go? That was a requirement that he had to come and and talk to my mom.
Okay.
And it was quite a trek for him. If you let him tell the story, he he flew in on a propeller plane, which he really did. And you know, back then there was no Google Maps and all that stuff, so trying to give him directions was a little tough. It's like, you know, you're gonna take Highway 17. When you get to the first barn that's red, you're gonna turn right.
It was like that.
Yeah, you pass this cornfield. As soon as you pass it, you got to make your immediate left. I mean, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but that's the way he tells the story. You know, but he came, had dinner, and I'll never forget this. That what he told my mom. He said, Ms. Becton, I can promise you three things. One, your son is going to get a great education. Two, he's going to leave the university a better, he's better man. And three, I'm going to treat him like he's my son. But before he said all of that, what he told my mom, and there's no coaches now that ever say this, wow. He told her, I don't know if your son had ever played down at Notre Dame.
Wow.
Yep.
Wow. But that's really interesting, though, because if you started with that and then like kind of like said those other comments, I mean, that in a sense, I mean, like you said, no coach would ever say that. But, and I don't know if it's because we had won a national championship and we were that good, but the idea that, hey, I just told you that your son's going to graduate.
Mm-hmm.
I just said that your son's going to become a better man. Now, I don't know how many coaches back in the day were saying that stuff to parents.
Right.
But to have the precursor to say, oh, by the way, I don't know if your son will ever play at Notre Dame. I mean, that's interesting.
I mean, it was interesting, but, you know, Coach's mentality was he wanted you to come to Notre Dame for the education piece, and he will help you with the football piece.
Right.
But, you know, he wanted that educational piece to be at the forefront.
And so now I'm assuming as you are looking at the rosters of all these schools you're being recruited by, I mean, you got folks like Rodney Culver, Reggie, Jerome, like, are you like, you know what, I'm that good. I'm about to take that spot. Like, how did, like, I mean, what happened there?
I seriously, and I've told people this and people don't believe me, but I had no intentions of playing. None.
Really?
So I was going to be one of the first in my family to go to college, and my ultimate goal was to get my education, and Notre Dame was going to provide that for me, and it was going to be a really good education. And so I was like, yeah, I'm going to come here. I'll play in practice, do practice, and that'll be about it. But there was no way I was going to beat out Tony Brooks, Rodney Culver. Back then, Willie Clark was even at running back.
Wow.
Reggie was going back and forth. I was Jerome. And then they brought in like three more my freshman year. Yeah, I'm like, there's no way.
Wow. Now, that's really – so, Lee, I did not know that, right? So it kind of reminds me a little bit about my venture to Notre Dame. I actually thought that they had misunderstood, like they didn't watch the proper film because I didn't think I was that good. And I literally – and I told my mom this, I told my high school football coach this, when I signed that letter of intent – I was like, I think we fooled them. Like, I never thought. I mean, come on, man. I didn't know about college. Anyway, I get there, and there's like 500 linebackers. So I know, kind of like you, hey, man, I came here. There's a purpose, and that purpose is for me to be the first person in my family to ever graduate from college. So that was my intention. And so it's funny to hear someone say that, those exact comments that, you know, my intent, mm-hmm. I never thought I would play at Notre Dame. So that's kind of interesting to hear. You're, yeah. I would have to say you're the only person who's ever told me that before.
Yeah, I was dead serious. Like I was content with it. I was completely right. fine with that.
Okay, so now you are there, and you're now teammates with Rocket. You're now teammates with I'm sorry. You've seen Rocket. I mean, you're there with Reggie, Rodney at the time, Jerome. I mean, how was that experience? Was that pretty cool? Or
oh man, it was amazing. Like, so as soon as I got there, Jeff Burris was my, you know, back then coach gave you a big brother.
Right, right.
So Jeff was my big brother.
Okay.
And he took great care of me. Showed me everything, you know, showed me how to act, how to be, and all of that good stuff. And then, lo and behold, Tony and Reggie took me under their wing. Don't know why. Have no idea why, but Tony was like, something about you I like, and he put his arm around me, and he's like, yep, you're coming with me. I was like, what was I going to say to him other than okay?
Right, right, exactly.
So it was great. You know, Jerome was great. Like, we were such a tight-knit group of backs, and nobody had an ego. That was the great thing about it. Nobody had any ego about how many carries they got or how many yards. It was, hey, how are we as a group going to perform? And that was the most important thing.
That's I mean, to have that type of talent and to have that attitude, I mean, that's terrific, man. So how was your first year? Were you on the prep squad? Did you play any? I mean, how was it? Well, first of all, answer that question, because I want to talk about kind of how that change was being a star in high school and stuff.
Yeah, so first couple games, I didn't play. And
we're on special teams?
No, nothing. Okay. I didn't play at all. And something changed at practice. Some play happened, and Coach Beck was kind of liked me at the time and got me more involved down with the ones and twos. And I remember we were playing Michigan State, and I get called over, and Coach Holtz says, do you want to play? And this is the third quarter. I said, yeah, I want to play. He's like, well, it's going to be mop-up roles, you know, but you'll play. I'm like, okay. And all the other guys, all the other running backs wanted to see me play because, you know, they saw my shiftiness in practice, sure. and wanted to see me out, do this out on the field against the, you know, another team.
Right.
So they put me out there, and yeah, shook some guy and got like 28 yards or something like
nice.
That.
Nice.
Yeah. So it was, and so I played, you know, pretty much every game from then on. And nice. I started playing in special teams and kickoff returns and stuff like that. So,
I mean, how was so the first couple of games you didn't play, you were kind of content. You were fine with that. I mean, you're like, you know, hey, I'm at this great school. If I play, I play. It's cool. I had a great run of high school. I'm fine with that.
I was really. Completely fine.
That's great, man. That's terrific. Yeah. Okay, so then now you're kind of sharing time with these guys. I'll go kind of year by year, but I mean, do you remember what was your favorite moment your first year playing wise? And it doesn't necessarily have to be a game. I mean, it could be, you know, a team meeting or, I mean, something. I mean,
it was definitely the first time I ran out the tunnel. Well, it was the first time I ran out the tunnel.
Okay.
We were playing Indiana. And remember back then, when you come down the stairs, you went down further and you came up to come out the tunnel.
Right.
And so you come down there and it's dark and all that stuff. And you, you know, and then it's like, go to the light, you know, that's one of the most amazing feelings ever.
That's the first time, huh? Yeah, that's pretty cool. Oh, and so for those folks who might not know, who've never done that before, now they actually have tours that go there and it's really pretty. It's nice. It's painted really well. But even back in the day, so I can't imagine like what it was like 10, 15 years before you and I got there, right? I mean, it's still, it was still kind of crazy because it was crazy back then and it was kind of narrow, you know, I mean, trying to get to it and you actually kind of get out there. And it's funny because as you're saying, you know, my first time coming out, I didn't necessarily get the goosebumps. I didn't necessarily see, I mean, people talk about, you know, that they could feel that special moment. The special moment for me was when our opponents were in the tunnel too. And it was so cramped in there. And now, which I don't know how, why they, and maybe, I don't know, people weren't aggressive back in the day, but why they would let us come out at the same time. I do not understand that. I like the way they have it now where they come out separate areas. But I remember standing like literally inches away from my opponent that I wanted to kill. And I'm like, let's do this now. So I never kind of got like the goose pimples and I never heard the ghosts in the tunnel because I was always like, you know, hey, let's go fight these guys right now. Which I thought that was really weird. Like why they would let people opponents, you know, stay in the tunnel at the same time. It was just kind of weird to me.
Yeah, that was weird, especially because, like you said, it was really tight. Like, it was tight.
And it's interesting because, like, even though they've obviously done a great job with the new stadium, you know, I kind of like the smaller bowl. I mean, I think it was still 59 when you were there, right?
Yep.
And, I mean, you could almost see, like, from the field, you can like see somebody. You can see somebody like in the top row and like wave to them. You know, now it's, you need binoculars or whatever. But I thought it was more kind of a wholesome, better feeling. And I thought the excitement from the fans. I mean, that's what kind of got me pumped up. And they were kind of yelling and stuff like that. So I don't know how you felt about that, but it was really a great experience.
I mean. You know, back then they also had the bleachers out in the corners and stuff like that. It just felt so intimate and it felt like there was like 150,000 people there because they were all on top of you.
Right.
But yeah, the atmosphere was just crazy. I mean, back to my recruiting, I never came to a Notre Dame game on my recruiting visit. Yeah. I never saw a game until I came to Notre Dame. Yep.
Wow. That's interesting. All right. So now, you're playing. How about your second year? Did you have a great moment? Your second year, I mean, how did that go for you?
Second year went good, other than the fact that I was behind Reggie Brooks, who just went bananas.
Well, he was running too, you know? I mean,
geez. How do you ever touch the field behind a guy that's getting 8 yards every time he touches the ball?
Eight.
Man. But I loved it. You know, me and Reggie roomed together, so it was awesome. It's bittersweet. It was, I ended up starting a game because Reggie had tweaked something, started it, and then I got yanked pretty quickly. not for anything that I did wrong, but you know, we had to get Reggie back in there. He was ready to go. I went for 65 and he went for 165, you know. Nah, it was good.
All right, let's take like maybe a 10 second pause here. I'm gonna run a little commercial. See, that's what you call big time, man. We got commercials now, you know.
Man, I like it.
Hey, man, watch out, watch out. Okay, so now you have a chance to kind of, you're doing well. You're playing behind Reggie. Reggie just had this crazy, insane year. I think, was he like fourth in the Heisman or something like that? Or
yeah, yep.
I mean, how does that work off of 1 year, right? I mean, it's incredible, man.
It was phenomenal. When you saw
first hands, I'm like, damn.
Yeah. I just couldn't, like, watching him was like playing Tecmo Bowl. You know, you give it to Bo Jackson, there's a chance he's taking it to the house every time. God. Unless you don't pick, if you don't pick the right defense, Bo was taking it to the house. And that's what it was like playing behind him and watching him, you know. But he taught me a lot. He taught me a lot about work ethic and different things like that. So it was great playing behind him.
So you mentioned before it was a great, great group. You know, you guys, you know, applauded each other, behind each other. I mean, can you talk to us a little bit about the camaraderie that went along with this tight group? Yes, you guys are a tight group, but still, I mean, you guys are fighting for playing time, right? And so, I mean, how was that? I mean, you mentioned a little bit before, but can you go a little bit deeper on that?
Yeah, you know, of course, everyone wants to play, but at the same time, it was more about how do we perform as a group? How does the group continue to help the team win football games? You know, if Reggie comes out for a play or two or three plays, whatever, if not come in the game, there doesn't need to be a drop off in play.
Right.
It might be a drop off in a yard and a half per carry, but it can't be, you know, this huge drop off.
Right.
And that's how it was. That was the camaraderie we always built, is about the unit as a whole. And yeah, that was what was most important to us.
So was there a moment where kind of like, I mean, kind of all encompassing, like, wow, I'm at Notre Dame, or, you know, wow, this is a great feeling? Or was it just kind of, you know, hey, you know, I'm here, let me do this? I mean, did you ever pinch yourself at one point? Like, it may have even been your first game in front of, like, you know, 60,000 people, but, like, did you ever have one of those moments?
I can't say I had that a moment once I was finally at Notre Dame, but I had that moment on my recruiting visit.
Okay.
And I did something a lot of recruits probably don't do or wouldn't do. But so I was leaving late Sunday, and the GA asked me, he was like, what do you want to do? Because the majority of the other recruits were gone.
Right.
I said, let's just go get something to eat at La Fortune. He was like, okay. So we go to La Fortune, and I said, just leave me here by myself. Let me just sit here by myself, because I wanted to see how people interacted with each other. Okay. And that's when it hit me, like, wow, I'm actually at Notre Dame, which I thought was this mythical place, but I'm right. Like, I'm actually here. And so that's what it hit me. And it started making me think that this is something that I can do.
And La Fortune was like a student union where they have like a barbershop, they have like all these food court, they have like a food court and stuff like that where people kind of hang out. So kind of along those lines, and not taking away from that moment, can you kind of share with us a memorable moment from that was non-athletic? I always ask guys this because I'm curious to kind of hear what people say, but just wondering if you had a moment, or what do you most remember that was non-athletic?
Wow. You know, you do a lot of interviews, Chris, and this is one of those questions I've never been asked, so I've never thought about it.
Sorry about that, man.
Yeah, you got me on the spot here. Man.
I mean, it can be anything from, like, literally trudging from La Fortune to your dorm at 50,
you know what?
You know, 50-degree weather or 50 below weather.
I got one for you. So it was my freshman year, and and winter comes, and I wake up and I look outside my window and there's snow on the ground. So I'm like, awesome, there's no class. Everything is shut down. So I'm laying there and the phone rings in my dorm room. I'm like, why is my phone ringing? So I pick it up and it was a GA and he's like, why aren't you in class? Wow. I said, did you not look outside? There's snow on the ground. He said, get to class. Walk out the door, the dorm room, and the sidewalks are completely cleared and everything. I'm like, oh my God, what have I done? What have I done? I mean, that was, for me, that was normal.
Right, right. Well, yeah, of course. Did you bring the proper clothes the first time you came up, or did you have to kind of borrow some stuff? Or
I was doing a little borrowing. I wasn't.
Or did you go to like the equipment room and get a whole bunch of sweatshirts and stuff like that, man?
I was getting it from everywhere. I wasn't 100% prepared for what happened.
I think it's you can tell the kids from the South because they literally would be wearing like a parka. And then like flip flops or something like that, or like their stuff would be borrowed from everybody on the team or everybody in the dorm, and you'd be like, "Wow, he's definitely from the South because he had no idea." Or and I forgot who it was, but somebody my year, they just had like 6 sweatshirts on, and you can see because they look like the Michelin Man, and I'm like, "Man, it's not that cold outside, bro."
Yes, it was. Oh, I'll never forget that.
All right. So now we're kind of going toward how about your junior year? What was that like?
Junior year was pretty good. That was probably my best year at Notre Dame.
Okay.
I was a starting running back, so it was that was a fun year. We played well, and the great thing about it, no one expected anything from us. It was, you know, we had a whole new backfield.
Right.
Kevin McDougal was at quarterback. Ray Zellers was at fullback. And I was at tailback. And now defense was pretty good. Offensive line was good. You know, we had A.T. Ruddy and all those guys. But nobody expected us to do much because we just lost the fourth, you know, the guy that finished fourth in the Heisman. And Jerome Bettis. So and Rick Meyer. So nobody expected us to do much, but we held our own.
Well, that was a pretty exciting year. So I mean, you had some great ups and downs actually. So I mean, so obviously for my area, it was our Miami game. I'm assuming for your era it was the Florida State game. Is that correct?
That is correct. Absolutely.
Okay. So, I mean, can you kind of – I mean, I don't need a minute by minute, but literally I can tell you what I did that whole day for the Miami game. I knew that shit was going to be special, right? So, I mean, kind of walk us through kind of the things you remember about that game. Kind of was there a lot of hype around it? Like talk to us about it.
The hype was insane. The parking lot, you know, back then they could have the RVs.
The RVs, yeah.
Yeah. So the RVs were there on Tuesday. I don't know where other people parked because the parking lot was packed on Tuesday. And, you know, Coach Holtz during practice did a great job of just keeping us level-headed, making us just work on us. But the hype truly hit when – when they came to town with their little funky hats on and, you know, was making fun of Newt Rockne and all of this stuff. That's when it really got serious.
Okay.
And, there was, I put it like this, and this is no joke. If you ask anybody that played on that team, they'll say the same thing. At no point did we think that we would lose. There was never a doubt that we thought we would ever lose.
Ever.
Ever.
That is awesome.
I wish we could have played them again.
Right, right, right. Exactly. All right. So now, one of the things that I enjoyed, which, I mean, I don't care if I played one down or I started my whole career, I loved going to mass before the games. And at that point, they only allowed like the coaches, players, and maybe one or two wealthy alumni that no one knew, like who is this dude in our mask, like type thing, you know, or a couple priests. Now I heard it's like a free, I mean, there's like 1,000 people now. I mean, I heard it's a free for all, but back in the day,
yeah.
And it was in one of those, it was like in one of the small dorms, like at the end of campus.
Yeah.
After St. Ed's, maybe, I forgot what dorm was in, but I loved it because I felt like, I mean, and no one said a word. And I kind of looked around. I was like, man, these are the guys I'm going to war with. Mm-hmm. And by any means, I'm not trying to compare war and football by any means. But as an 19-year-old kid, like, you know, I'm about to go out and try to destroy and dominate somebody. And the only people that are going to be with me, the only people that I care about are the people in this room right now. Like, I love my mom, but my mom wasn't in the room, so I wasn't even thinking about her, right? So I was just going to war with these guys. And from that mass, like I knew, like, you know, getting up from my dorm or whatever, or I'm sorry, getting from the hotel, coming to campus, and I knew from the mass to the player walk to that stadium, like that was the best experience of my life. So I can't imagine how it was for that game.
Man, oh wow, yeah, there was people everywhere, for one thing. But for me, and this is it's a little different. So I'm not a hype person. I don't get hyped. I'm very calm. So my ritual, and I did it every game, I'm listening to like Boys to Men or what, all these different types of slow jams. And what I'm thinking about the whole time is, okay, if we run 24 zone, if the nose crosses the center, what am I going to do? If the end crashes down, what am I going to do? You know, like, so I'm running all these scenarios in my head of the plays. That's what I did from when we got left Plymouth.
Okay.
Until I got to the locker room.
Sure.
That's what I did the entire time. That was my entire focus point.
Wow. So, I mean, do you remember that the player walk for that game? I mean, when you said there were a lot of people. I mean, were people kind of like nuts? I think it was game day there?
It was the first ever college game day on campus.
Okay.
I had four of my buddies from my high school team were up, which made it even better. It was crazy. Wow. Yeah, the walk, I mean, they did a great job. You know, we weren't getting accosted or anything like that. But, I mean, there was 500,000 people on campus, you know. So, back then, there was just less control.
Sure.
So it was crazy. It was exciting. It was fun. But – you know, we tried to stay more composed because we knew what we had to do. I mean, this team was scoring 50 some points a game. They were blowing people out, you know.
Right.
And you know, now they're in our house and they had been disrespecting our house. So it was time for business. It was strictly business.
So walk us through a couple highlights of the game.
Let's see here. One of the best highlights for me wasn't even a scoring play. It was I was running right, and I made one guy miss, and so then Derek Alexander is coming up. I'm sorry, Derek Brooks.
Yeah.
And me and Ray, because I was like, I'm not going around him, I'm going through him. And me and my boy Ray Zellers kind of both hit him at the same time and folded him.
Is that when he got knocked out of the game?
That's when he got put out the game.
Yeah.
to me, that was one of my the best moments.
Nice.
And then the probably the next one was we put in this wrinkle, this little swing pass that we had never run before.
Okay.
And K-Mac was just I caught one with my left hand one-handed and got like 20 yards on it. That was pretty memorable.
So speaking about K-Mac, Kevin McDougal, and I actually hung out with him a little bit because he came up early. I want to say like maybe – like a month or month and a half early, and they didn't have any place to put him. And so one of my boys lived off campus, Tim Ryan, and I used to go over hang out with him and, yeah, and room with him a lot. And Vinny was like, hey, man, can you stay here? And we're like, yeah, sure. And so we spent like a month with Kevin McDougal, who was this shy kid who apparently was a damn scratch golfer, which I had no idea. He's almost like a damn pro. And you talk about smooth, calm, and collective? Oh, my God.
I call him K-Mac, but Kevin McDougal, yeah, that was my guy. Me and him hung out a lot. Did you know that he was really good at BMX bike, BMX racing as well?
I didn't know. What? He was from Florida, right?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. He
was just an athlete. But and then talk about one of the coolest cats.
Oh, my God. And calm. Just like, like literally, the house could be on fire. And he's like, hey, you know what? Let's go. Here's the exit over here. Yeah. Let's go ahead and go out the exit.
And he's not going to run to it. He's going to stroll
right,
to it.
Right. But now, I know at one point, he held some like crazy, like single season record or something like that. Do you remember?
The completion record.
Okay.
He was at like 67-68%, something like
that. 1 year?
I
mean, come
on. 1 year.
But again, like you said, I mean, he had everybody and his mother there. All right. The seconds are ticking down in this game. And if I remember correctly, they finished on – was it an interception or they finished on defense? I forgot what was it. Do you remember?
The game finished when Sean Wooden knocked the pass.
That's what it was. Right. Okay. So the euphoria – I mean, what happened? Did y'all like – did you lose your mind? I mean, like what was going – what was going across your mind?
Is this real? Did this really just happen? Like, how is this even possible? You know, because you got to remember, everybody had been talking about how great Florida State was. It was the best team that's ever been assembled. You know, no one's ever even going to come close to beating them. And the game really wasn't as close as it was.
Right.
You know, we had another guy that had the ball in his hands. He was tipping it, and the guy ended up catching it.
Mm-hmm.
Or we would have probably beat them by 21. But it was one of those moments that you'll never forget. And I remember when I got in the locker room, it was – you opened the door to try to leave. Just wouldn't happen. You'd have never got anywhere. You know, so – you know, you're trying to find back ways out the stadium because you're never, like you just wouldn't have never gotten anywhere. And it was funny. So I ended up meeting, I had somebody get my four friends to meet me over by Joyce. And I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go show them, you know, the Heisman trophies and different things like that. And I start walking up the stairs and I hear people cheering and stuff. And I'm like, what is going on? What's happening up here? I walk upstairs and they were doing ESPN Game Day Live.
No way. Right by the trophy area.
Yep. And I was like, uh-oh. Cause then people were like, lay back. And I'm like, uh-oh.
Oh my God.
Ain't gonna be good. Yeah. And so they came over, talked to me, and I ended up doing an interview with them.
Just from that?
Just from that.
Wow. Wow. I think they came to you like, sorry, guys, you know.
Yeah, it was too late to turn around.
Right. And then at that point, you know, you can't, I mean, like, you just won. I mean, so I get a turn down like game day.
No.
All right. So now, so the how far? How many games was it until the Boston College game?
The very next week.
Oh, was?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I don't remember that. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm gonna take on this emotional high.
So now, and this now you're gonna drop me down again. Now, huh?
Yeah, man. This is part of it, man. So I mean, obviously you guys are riding. I mean, this great way. And again, I know Holtz is like, hey, everybody's better than we are, whatever. So I mean, we could skip all that, but like talk to us about that game. Like, I mean, because it was. Well, I'm not going to tell you my experience, but go ahead. Sorry. You were there.
It really was a tough emotional week.
Okay.
And game. Myself and Ray Zellers didn't even start.
Mm.
And within the blink of an eye, we're down 21 points. And so, you know, then me and Ray come in there and they were just playing really well and we could not figure out what to do in the first half. And so, of course, then Coach Holtz realized what to do. And so we literally in the second half went to running draws like almost every play.
Jeez.
Because they were getting so much pressure. Right. Like they were just bringing everybody in, and we started doing that, and we started gashing them.
Okay.
I remember, like, this is where the high comes in, and then the low comes in. We're down 21 with probably 8-9 minutes left on the clock, and we make a comeback of all comebacks, and take the lead. With a minute and something left in the game.
Jesus.
And for it to end on a field goal from that distance was pretty tough.
I can see it. Man, you're still like, oh, God.
I mean, you just – you think back and I, you know, I look at my – within, and I'm like, man, what could I have done differently in the first half?
Sure.
So that we wouldn't have been in that deficit. What right. could I have done? And that was tough. That was a heartbreaker.
So what was the locker room like after that? I mean, you know, were guys just like throwing chairs, or were they? Was it quiet? Like, what was the scene?
It was quiet and crying. There was a lot of tears. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of it was from the seniors and the juniors. You know, because you know how it was. The juniors, you play hard for the seniors. You know, because this is it for them.
Right.
And it was like, it was hard looking, you know, me and Aaron Taylor are good friends. It was hard looking at AT and knowing that this is how, you know, the last regular season game ended. Mm. It was very emotional.
Mm. What bowl games you guys go to?
Went to the Cotton Bowl and played A&M.
Okay, so now I remember that you guys won that game, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I remember that there was an issue. Notre Dame could still have won the national championship. I mean, what was that conversation like?
We fully expected to get to share. Fully expected to share. I mean, there was buttons had us, you know, sharing the title. You know, it hurts to say. See, now, granted, we had our own destiny in our hands,
right?
But for a team that you beat, for them to then win the national championship against both of them, when there's been other seasons where they split it
Right.
That was the second heartbreak.
When you say both, can you explain that? You're talking about the coaches poll and
the AP poll.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Yeah.
So who had Notre Dame?
They didn't split it. That was
the point. I'm sorry. I got you.
Yeah, that was the point.
Okay.
Right. We were expecting for that to happen because happened. There had been precedent of it happening, and didn't happen.
God. So now you played well in the Cotton Bowl, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So was that any type of redemption from the shitty feeling you had, you know, the last game?
It was. It you know, Texas A&M was a really good team. They had the Wrecking Crew defense.
Mm-hmm.
And we went out and, you know, I had like 126 yards and got really MVP well. And all that stuff. So it was a redemption on that part of it. You know, but in the back of our minds, we were still nervous. Like, it's now out of our hands. You know, we can't, it's not controlled on the field. So there's nothing else that we can do other than what we just did. So there was joy, but then there was that like, oh, what's going to happen? You know, what am I going to wake up to in the morning? Am I going to wake up and be really happy, or am I going to wake up and be really sad?
All right, so now it's your senior year. So how different was kind of, I mean, it's not like every year you get a chance to compete for the national championship. So, I mean, what was the difference between the experience you had your junior year to your senior year?
For me, you know, I got voted captain, which was a great honor. You know, being captain at Notre Dame is a special thing. And it, you know, because back then it was voted on by the team. And mm-hmm. so it was great that the guys on the team felt that I could lead them. And as you know, so I worked hard in the off season and all of that stuff, bulked up and, you know, just got myself, my body ready to play. And the season was tough because my body ended up letting me down.
Mm.
I ended up getting hurt and missed 5 games. So it was really tough, you know, coming off that the previous year and then having to miss that much time when you're one of the leaders on the team.
Right. Right. So I mean, was it in the beginning of the year or toward the end of the year that you got injured?
It was towards the beginning. It was, okay. I think it was second game against Michigan State.
In 5 games,
Yeah. I tore my lower abdominal muscles.
Okay, I don't even know what those are. But I'm sure I don't have them, but
yeah. I ain't got any now. I had a couple then.
All right, so, I mean, you have a chance to graduate. I mean, did you think about the NFL? Were other guys talking about that? I mean, it sounds like in the beginning, you know, your freshman was like, hey, this is fine if I don't play, but you know, afterward you played stuff like that, you want to have a chance to see if you can go on to that next level. What was that like?
Yeah, so you know, by now those are thoughts that are in my head, you know, okay, I can play with these guys, you know, after seeing you tear someone's head off,
right.
I'm like, all right, I can work with that. So I did have aspirations and different things like that and wanted to, you know, kind of see that dream come true. But once again, you know, injuries, you know, have a way of sometimes taking things like that away from you. So I actually ended up having a pretty major wrist surgery right after I played in the Hula Bowl.
Okay.
And it was pretty significant. And but it was something that it had to happen. Like it, I there was no way around me not having the surgery. So,
gotcha. So now I read somewhere that rugby.
Yeah.
What the hell? First of all, I don't know how to play rugby and never seen it. How did you get into rugby?
Man, it was crazy. I was I was still, you know, this couple years later, I took some time off to let my wrist heal and was ready to work my way back into football. And okay. So I'm up in Canada playing. And all of a sudden, you know, season gets over. I'm feeling good. I'm like, okay. A guy comes up and he says, calls my agent and says, hey, they're looking for some guys to represent the United States in this World Sevens tournament. So you play all these other countries.
Wait, did you even know what that was? I mean, like,
heck,
like
no, never even heard of it. No,
what's your agent like, hey, Lee, check this out. I got a phone call.
Yeah, I looked at it a little bit, and they're like, yeah, you'll be there for 30 days. They'll teach you the game. I'm like, okay, I'll go. And so I go, and ended up playing well, and a club was like, hey, we want to sign you. And so I was like, okay, I'll do this. You know, this is Sydney's beautiful place. So I ended up doing that for almost 2 years until, once again, another injury. Messed up my shoulder blade. And at that point, I was like, oh, you know what? I don't think I need to wake up in pain anymore. I'm kind of over this.
Wait a minute. Okay, yeah, so backtrack us a little bit. All right, so you don't know how to play the game.
Nope.
Had you ever heard of it before?
I'd heard of it.
Okay.
And this is where I got educated. There's two different types of rugby. There's what they call rugby union and then rugby league. And okay. So union is what you see a lot here in the States.
Okay.
Where you see the big scrums
right.
And the people are right there at the line and they're pushing each other back and forth.
Okay.
So there's that. And then league is completely different. And so I was playing in league, which is way more wide open. You can get what they call line breaks and different things like that. The problem is it literally is like being on a kickoff the entire game.
Oh, because my Lord.
What happens is every time someone gets tackled, the defense has to run back 10 meters. The offense runs back. And then you just, once again, come back and run at each other again.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, with no pads on.
I was going to say that. So
and you do that the whole game. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And there's only so many interchanges. So, you know, you're not just playing offense. You're playing defense as well. Like, you're playing – yeah, it was – but I will tell you this. I was probably in the best shape because
the cardio
you have to play is insane.
That's crazy. So yeah. Were you able to pick it up right away or?
There was 10 of us, 12 of us. Given us the ball.
Didn't know how to play, or were Americans or what?
All Americans. Okay. There was a couple guys that was already there, and they knew how to play.
Okay.
But giving us the ball to run with, you had to learn everything because we're used to running with our pads down, right? No, you're gonna get your head broke. You got to run and get thin, like you got to turn and do all this other stuff.
Oh my!
And so that was a challenge. And then, you know, you got the ball. You might have to pass it or offload it, as they say. So learning how to pass the ball and all of that stuff. I mean, we we picked it up fairly quickly. The good thing about sevens is there's only seven people out there, so we've got a lot more space to maneuver.
Yeah, but there's a lot more space. I mean, because you're playing on a football field, right?
It's bigger than a football field.
Gee, wait, come on.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Oh, my Lord. Yeah, I could imagine. You probably weren't in the best shape of your life. That's crazy.
I was. But, you know, ended up learning it, and it was fun. It was a great, great experience.
So I was living in Australia. I mean, did you room with anybody? Did you stay there year-round? Like, what did you do?
Yeah, so they actually had – so it was me and two other guys stayed together. They put us up and everything. So, yeah, it was – stayed right off Bondi Beach.
That sounds really nice.
It was a good experience.
When you played folks and I don't know, I may be out of bounds here, but when you played folks, were they kind of pissed off y'all were Americans, or was there any animosity there? Were they like, hey, how do you get these American football players go over here thinking they can play rugby?
There were some, but the majority was actually pretty cool. You know, we weren't going to come in and just take somebody's spot, but we were a good change of pace for the team. Okay. But the majority of the guys were awesome. They would help you. They would, you know, give you pointers and try to make sure, you know, you understood your spacing. Everything is about spacing. Running the proper line, and so they were actually pretty good.
Wow. Well, that's a definite experience. All right, so let's fast forward a little bit. We actually reconnected because you used to throw some kick-ass tailgates at Notre Dame when your kid was there.
Yeah.
So, I mean, can you just kind of share with us a little bit about, I mean, how great these things were, because I remember some legendary ones.
Man, they were pretty fun. You know, it was just one of those things where I enjoyed, you know, seeing people happy, seeing people smile, seeing people having fun. You know, I was kind of a crazy person about it. I'm getting up super early in the morning. I'm being the first one out there. You know, I need to get in my, I need the perfect spot. And yeah, I was a little crazy about it. But you know, it was one of those places where, you know, a lot of people could come gather, you know, and have a good time. Yeah, it was a good time.
When did you start those? Do you remember the year?
2012.
Okay.
2012, 2013, something like that.
So, and that was every home game.
Oh yeah, every home game.
And you say that you were anal about this, but I fully respect that because you want it done right. And you work hard for, you know, 2-3 hours setting it up. And then after that, you're able to relax, which I think is great. And then everything is where it's supposed to be. People come in, have a good time. And I don't think people appreciate that, because when putting on a real tailgate like you do, I mean, that takes a lot of practice. And it takes people understanding how important that is.
Yeah, it takes practice. It takes help. There's a lot that goes into it. You know, and one of the cool things about where I was tailgating is the people that were around me, we all became good friends. And so it was weird, like the tailgates that were happening the first year, by time, you know, got to the third year, were so much better.
Wow.
You know, like each year you just progressed. But yeah, it was great. It was, I mean, I'm missing them right now. Like, this is hard for me. Cause this time of year, that's what's supposed to be happening and it's not. So,
right.
But you know, they will happen again and you will be invited.
Well, thank you. So during that time, were you even going to the games or were you just getting prepared for, okay. All right. So you go to the games. So you shut everything down, go to the game and then come back out.
Yep.
Oh my gosh. And for those folks who haven't seen like a professional tailgate, I mean, your stuff was legendary. I mean, I'd have my little table, my little brats I made the night before. My man got all that stuff out, plus more. Plus he has like a live bar air drinking area. I mean, it was. So I can't wait to have those again. I may just park next to you just to say, hey, I'll carry the chairs or something just so I can help out.
Anytime.
All right, so we're going to wind down a little bit. So tell us what you're doing now.
So I live out in Arizona. I'm a mortgage loan officer.
Oh, you do? What's the weather out there? So it's not as gloomy as it is here in the Midwest?
No, not quite. I mean, I think it was maybe 90 today, 92, not a cloud in the sky, something like that. Go on walks, hikes, whatever you want to do. It's beautiful.
Wow.
Loving it.
Wow.
But this time of year out here. Now, mind you, you know, it gets hot in the summertime, but this time of year is when the weather is just perfect. So, but I'm a mortgage loan officer out here for a company called Waterstone Mortgage. And, we lend in 47 states and I do loans for people all over the country. I do a lot right in Indiana, cause I know quite a few people there.
Okay.
And it's fun. You know, there's nothing better than, you know, helping someone either, purchase their first home or their forever home or refinance to better their financial situation. So, I love doing it. And, it's something that's a true passion of mine.
And you've been in the industry for a while, right? So you kind of know what you're doing.
Mm-hmm. So I know what I'm doing.
Is it a set? I mean, are you traveling or can you do this from the comforts of your lawn chair in your yard? What, looking at mountains in Arizona? Like, I mean, how does that work?
I can travel. I can do it from the lawn chair looking at the mountains. I can do it on the beach looking at the ocean. Long as I got my laptop, I can do my job.
That is great, man. So, I mean, we're going to wind down a little bit, but I mean, have you talked to anybody, any former old teammates you haven't seen in a while, or I mean, guys you keep in touch with? I mean, you mentioned Ray and also Aaron. Who else?
Yeah, man. Who else have I talked to? I talked to Brian Hamilton from time to time.
Okay.
I talked to Reggie quite often. You know, we got a huge text chain going on. So there's quite a few guys that, you know, you converse with kind of on a regular basis.
Okay. Is there anybody in the Arizona area by you or?
Yeah, so I got Bert here, Bert Ranberry.
Okay.
Irv Smith is here. I do work with Irv. Irv's a realtor. Nick Smith is out here. There's a few guys, and then like Scott Palumbo's out here. So there's a few guys out here.
Nice. Actually, almost forgot, but another one of our bonding times. Somehow you were thinking about getting a motorcycle or, you know, living around and talking to Tony Rice. Somehow we talked you into being our trail car and making the trip to Sturgis, South Dakota with us. Had you ever been on a bike trip like that?
That was awesome. No, I hadn't. I had not. And I can tell you that was an awesome experience. I had a great time. You know, you guys are a lot of fun. But, the significant others were riding in the Escalade with me. And we just sit there and talked about you guys and laughed at you guys the whole trip.
Man. And so like from Chicago to South, that's basically it's 950 miles, but we actually had a little break in there. But it's kind of interesting because, so we had obviously some significant others that didn't ride, but it was literally almost like a family affair. I mean, we had people cooking dinner, we had people washing dishes. I mean, it was just a great time.
It was, and it was I enjoyed all the different places that we went to. You know, we did all the sightseeing things. You know, it wasn't just, oh, we're going to go to Sturgis and go downtown and just be there. We did a lot more things, and that was the fun thing. You know, we took, like you said, it was more like a family. And so we took a lot of family pictures and stuff like that. So it was great. I'm up for the next one. And once again, I will be driving the van.
I was going to say, so can we convince you now to at least rent a motorcycle?
That is not happening.
Come on, man. Come on.
Not happening. You forgot you guys got caught in that rain. Not happening.
Well, but that's all part of it. It was like a Wednesday. It was like, hey, it doesn't matter. No, that's what happens.
I was dry and wasn't getting pelted.
Very dry. Yes, you were. Hey, Lee, man, this was awesome, man. You know, thank you so much for agreeing to do this. And hope you had a good time. I actually learned a lot. And one of the things that I think that kind of sticks out in my mind is, and only because I thought about it too when I was being recruited there, I had no intention of playing. I mean, the idea that I was going to do something that, I mean, I had other pressures, and that was, graduating from college. And so kind of playing, if I did have a chance to play, that would be kind of like the cherry on top or the bonus part, because I went there for a certain reason. So to hear, and I've never heard anybody say that. So that's one of the things that kind of stuck out in my mind. And the fact that you lived in Australia for freaking 2 years playing rugby, that had to be that's a whole different conversation we can get to sometime.
We'll talk about that another time.
That's awesome, man. Hey, man, thank you so much, man. I really, really appreciate it. After we hang up, I'm gonna get on the phone with Tony and tell him that we did this, if he's not already watching, because I think he'd get a kick out of the fact that I was talking to our trail car driver. So
man, hey, thank you very much for thinking of me and giving me the opportunity to chat with you. This was fun. I thoroughly enjoyed it. You're doing a great job, and I wish you nothing but the best, my friend.
Well, you're part of the family, man. It's not every day, you travel, 2 days in a motorcade with somebody, and you always remember. And then also the awesome freaking tailgates you used to do. So as I said before, man, I'm just gonna park next to you, see if I can carry some chairs or something.
All right, sounds good.
All right, man, thank you so much, man. I really appreciate it. Peace, brother.